I saw a guy in demo, people said, what color should I mix? And he made a color, and he mixed it from two different directions, starting with two different colors, and I was just like, wow, how'd you do that? Because there's such variation in color mixing. As a general rule, if it has a lot of white, start with white. If it has something that's graying it down, don't gray down till later. But don't think in terms of hue or whatever. Just think in terms of first percentage of white. That's key. And then we have to think of warm and cool too. But let me go back to the color wheel. Yellow, orange, red, violet, blue, green. And now I'm just going to talk about it in warm and cool. That's all I'm going to talk about it. Blues and greens are kind of cool, and oranges and reds are kind of warm. But in reality, if I have six hue pies here, every hue pie has warm and cool colors. So let's make up two colors. A super bright cool yellow, a super bright warm yellow. I'm going to mix them together. The resulting mixture is not here. It has to dip down. So let's say it dips down a little bit. That means if I just have these two yellows, whatever color exists in this little area, I can't get. It's a little dip. It's not a big deal. If I take that same theory and take a warm and a cool in every hue pie and connect them to give an idea of, well, what is my access to color space? It's huge. I have a lot of access to color space. My brain will work eventually. I'm scanning my table. This is where we need to edit the film. There it is, back here. Here are some color palettes. I'm talking about a spectral palette. It's down here. When you see these colors, and you might decide to Xerox this or copy this, this is just one spectral palette. It's a bright spectral palette. So if I decide I need a warm red and a cool red, and one person, let's say this half of the room, says, okay, we'll take cadmium red light as our warm and alizarin crimson as our cool. And the other side of the room goes, that's way too bright. We'll take burnt umber as our cool red, and raw sienna as our warm red. Those are browns, but they're in the red family. So it's not that you have to paint with bright colors, but you think warm and cool, everything expands. So, if I were to take yellow, red, blue, and limit myself to three colors, could I do a nice painting with three colors? Definitely. But I'm going to limit myself. First, we'll look at it in this graphic form. All the color that exists here, 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 I can't get. I've limited myself so much that it can affect the painting that I'm trying to do. I'm not talking about what the class is doing behind that blackboard, which is a specific project where they're limiting themselves on purpose for a specific reason. I'm talking about overall creativity and trying to choose a palette. Let's see what happens. I'm going to take the bottom of this color chart and do something that you're probably all familiar with. Blue, violet, red. And I'm going to give myself a challenge. I would like to mix bright purple. And I know that blue and red make purple. I'm looking at your hair. And we'll have a discussion later. Actually, it's perfect for right now. I'm glad you came in today. And I take ultramarine blue, and for some god-awful reason, I choose cadmium red medium. And I think, well, that's a really strong red. It's probably going to make this great purple. And I take a little bit of blue, some red, a little bit of white so we can see it. And here's my purple. Now, a question for you guys. Is this a good or a bad purple? Any other opinion?
Well, it depends on what you're doing. But
say that louder.
Depends on what you're doing.
Yes, it's neither good nor bad. It's just not bright. But I want it bright. So I made a mistake somewhere. Was my mistake in the blue or the red?
The red.
The red. Purple's cool. I think I chose a warm red. So now I'm going to choose a cool red. I'm going to choose a red called quinacridone. I'll take the same blue. I'll take the red. Not bad. Pretty good. A lot brighter. Have I solved my problem?
I have trouble seeing whether something is cool or warm. So do you just have to memorize it and know it, or can you really see the difference just from the original hue or color?
From my experience is that it's a combination of experience, and then experience.
Okay. I just need more time.
Unless something's weird with your eyes. So, I might have solved my problem, but what if I wanted her hair? And believe me, I do want hair. I take as much as I can get. But the color of her hair is closer to this color. Dioxazine purple. And nobody can mix this color. It is physically not possible. It's one pigment, carbazole dioxazine, super bright. So what this means is that if for some reason you need this color, you're going to have to buy it. I can mix it, but it's going to be grayer. So on the one hand, yes, it would be great for us to think as artists that we can mix any color we want, but that is not physically possible. There are certain colors you have to buy. Let's look at this brown. Transparent earth red, an amazing brown. Gamelin has this row here of these amazing single pigment browns. Luminous, transparent, great for all kinds of stuff, landscape, skin tone. I can't mix this color. I used to think I can mix a basic brown that is on everybody's palette. I used to think I can mix this brown. This is called burnt umber. And I might be able to mix the mass tone. I might even be able to mix different colors together to look like the tint, but I'm going to lose the luminosity. And one reason is another basic rule of color mixing. The more colors that you mix together, the more opaque the color mix becomes. Has to be. So how many colors do you mix together to make a brown? Late on it. You guys have mixed brown. I mean, if you're an oil painter and you move the brush around too long, brown magically appears. 2, 3, 4, 5. You mix a lot of colors together to make brown sometimes. So browns tend to have more of an opaque feel when we mix them ourselves. But if we need a brown that for a glazing technique or something that's transparent or translucent, you might find yourself having to buy it. So, who tells you whether you should buy a brown or mix a brown? I'll give you a hint. It's not.
Well, I mean, me.
Your painting.
No?
Oh, who said that? Say that louder.
Your painting.
The painting, you know, I've asked this question. I've got to give you some free paint for that. I've asked that question hundreds of times, and people stare at me. It's your painting. The painting tells you everything. So when you're painting, and for some reason, you decide to lighten a section of your painting, and you think you're lightening it because it was your idea, no, it was the painting's idea. You're looking at the painting, and it's telling you, not out loud, make me lighter, I'm too dark. So one of the hardest things I have found for young artists to be aware of, even experienced artists, is to respond to the painting, not to your head. Respond to what you're looking at. It tells you what to do. It's the connection that we have. And I don't know how you guys paint. I know exactly how you paint. You paint just like I paint. You paint the non-thinking state. You step back at some point and you look. Oh, that sucks. The thinking state. You go back and paint. The non-thinking state. You step back and look. The thinking state. Back and forth. Back and forth. It's called the flow of painting, rhythm of painting. Anything that you do that breaks that flow means the next time you make a mark, it's slightly harder. You come to set up your easel and you're going to paint. Is the first 5 minutes harder or easier than a half hour later? It's harder. You've got to connect it to the painting. Do you set up in the same area when you paint in the classroom? You tend to set up in the same area. You guys move around a lot?
Yeah.
Wow, that's unusual. Because usually people set up in the same spot because it's more comfortable. I'm going to digress for a second as long as I'm talking about this. Talk about something that is not in the lecture, but I can't help myself. Just so you don't feel like you're all alone. This is a wave. It's a little simplified, but it's a wave. It's called the rhythm of creativity. So let's look about the rhythm of creativity in terms of painting. You start here, and you say to yourself, this is going to be great. And you make a mark, and you start to slide downhill. You make another mark, and things are going wrong. It's like, wow, this is like, wow, this is hard. And maybe you hit rock bottom. I know what rock bottom is for me. I can't paint. Who am I kidding? But I don't stop. I keep on painting, and now I figure out some things. Oh, it's getting better. It's getting better. Okay. Finish the painting. I look at it. I go, okay, Glenn, way to go. I think I'll make another painting. But I don't want to go through this. That was pretty depressing. I'm just going to copy the good stuff. And you make some more paintings, but they're not quite as fresh as the earlier painting. So you go, oh, yeah. I'll try something new. And the second you try something new, you start going down that hill again until you start to figure things out. So the interesting thing about this flow of creativity, this rhythm, is that most of our time is spent doing things that don't work, figuring out solutions. This time is nothing. It's all this time that we're doing it. And it's not like one and one is two. Every mark, you respond and create a solution to the next mark, to the next mark, to the next mark. And so the wave is not like this, it's probably like, but it's kind of going like that. So, what is a painter? I have no idea, but in my mind, I think all a painter is a problem solver. We solve problems that we're staring in front of us. But we don't know what that solution is until we start doing it. It's not something you can think your way out of. You can only do your way out of it. If you don't like this way of solving problems, you won't paint. But it's exhilarating. It's painful. It's everything. And it's really good for your brain. I had a teacher explain this another way. And they explained to their class in words. They said, you start off your painting, you think, this is great. You start painting. Oh, this is tricky. Keep on painting. Oh, this sucks. You keep on painting. I suck. You take it inward. You keep on painting. Oh, this is not bad. You keep on painting. You're done. This is great. The same arc. And the interesting thing about the arc is it doesn't matter how good you are, doesn't matter how long you've been painting, the second you try something new, this process starts. So your instructor is no different than you are. He's just made more mistakes. Well, in fact, when I was teaching, it's going to sound really weird. I had a student come up to me and said, Glenn, how do you grade? I go, that's simple. The more mistakes you make, the higher your grade. Keep on making mistakes. Keep on taking risks. And my job as the instructor was to create this comfortable environment that when you failed, I wasn't going to kind of jump down on your back. That's another lecture. Let's look at this. What would happen if I combined green and red, which are complements? What color would I get? Black. Is there another color you might get?
Gray.
Gray. Is there another color you might get? Brown, thank you. Three colors. They're all correct. But I was brought up in New York City. Does it show? and only one of them is more beta. That would be black. Because we have to remember the color functions, hue, value, chroma. So you have two colors opposite the color wheel, green and red. And you think they're perfectly balanced, but one is a little lighter, you just can't see it, you get green. One is a little warmer, you just can't see it, you get brown. So, can you actually find two colors that you could buy off the rack that are perfectly balanced? You can. Quinacridone red and emerald green are perfectly balanced. And if I was fortunate enough to mix these in the right proportion, I would get black. Now, what Gamelin has done is they've taken this knowledge of color theory, of complementary colors, and they've made us a black that is perfect for toning down colors. And it's called chromatic black. And I can take an orange, and here I have a color called permanent orange. And I could take a little bit of this black and add it to it. Boy, that's pretty subtle. I can take a little bit more. And just slowly, as I keep on adding little bits and little bits, slowly gray it down. That's a lot of control. Why can I do that? Because this black has no black pigment in it. The two colors in this black, Dalo Emerald and Quinacridone Red, they've mixed it for you. So for me, chromatic black is in my palette. I always have it. Because that allows me to grab colors and keep the balance going. But that's not the only way to gray out colors. I mean, we could use complements, we could use this as a way to gray out colors, but as I was saying before, there's a lot of white in colors. So, Gamelin, since they're from Portland, they had made Portland gray light, Portland gray medium, Portland gray deep, colors that were black and white mixed together in different values so that you can mix them into your color and have a shortcut. Well, then they decided, well, wait a second, we really should be thinking about warm and cool. So they made Portland cool gray, Portland warm gray. These are pre-mixed colors that I could take. Let's say I'll take my orange. And mix it into the cool. I'll get one mixture. Mix it into the warm. I'll get another. You guys see the difference? These grays did all the work. I didn't do anything. It helped me maintain my flow. Now this is a tricky thing because you guys are in school and there is a great validity, I believe, in learning how to mix the long way so you know how things work. But at some point, as you're painting and you become more and more knowledgeable, you start to take different shortcuts that help your creative flow. A premix color like this does that. They've also done the same thing in white. I'll pick that up later. Warm white, cool white. Here I have a painting. One done with warm white, one done with cool white. All the colors in this painting are exactly the same, except here I mixed them with warm white, here I mixed them with cool white. And the whites did all the heavy lifting. I just was along for the ride. So when companies make all these colors, philosophy should be it helps us paint, not more color that people can buy. Gamelin is really good at that. They try to make stuff that makes sense for us. Let's talk about opacity. Here's a visual. Opaque, translucent, transparent. Thick, thin. A lot of interesting things are going on. I'm going to do something that's fairly complex. This will be the most complex thing I'm going to do today. So I hope I don't lose you. But just for your own understanding, so the next time you go into a museum and you look at an old master or an impressionist, you guys done that? Here's what's going on. Let's look at the old master and the impressionist. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to dissect these paintings layer by layer, so we could see what's actually going on in the painting layer by layer. The old masters painted in a method that we now call the indirect method, and the impressionist painted in a method that we now call the direct method. So let's look at the old master. First thing they had to do, well, they had to pick a substrate. Does anybody here know what that word means? It's a fancy art word. What we're painting on. Paper, plastic, metal, canvas, wood, that's your substrate. If it was canvas, the next thing that they had to do was they had to seal the canvas. They used a thing called rabbit skin glue. We still make it today from horses' hooves. Gamble makes a replacement called PVA sealer, more archival. This is a really trick question. I'd be shocked if anybody knows the answer to this. What is it that we are protecting in the canvas when we seal it? We are protecting the oil paint so it does not touch the canvas directly. What is it in the canvas we are protecting? It's tiny.
Fibers.
Think tinier.
Molecules.
Well, maybe we're a little too tiny.
I like it.
That was the smallest thing I could
think of. All right. I'll put it another way. What do these things have in common? A tree, a bush, a flower.
Organic and acid.
What are they made of? Cellulose. They're all made of cellulose. And we are protecting the cellulose in the canvas. In America, we are basically painting on cotton canvas. In Europe, they're basically painting on linen canvas. Linen comes from the flax plant, still cellulose. That's what we're protecting. Okay, the next thing they did was they put a ground on top. This is actually what you're painting on. If you're painting on acrylic gesso, the sealer and the ground are mixed together. Then they did an underpainting. They did the entire painting in a tonal range of one color. Maybe a weird brown or a weird gray or a weird green. The entire painting. Then they took some key colors that they loved that were maybe super opaque or super colorful and put them in certain areas of the painting that was needed. They had a color called lapis blue. Has anyone ever heard of lapis blue?
Comes from like that special region where you got no bag, gets that lapis.